So yesterday we worked out a specific example of spontaneous symmetry breaking. And the example was that we had a scalar field, single complex scalar field, which was transforming under a U1 gauge symmetry, which is just a phase. And you saw that under certain condition of the potential, the scalar field may get a non-zero value at its minimum. Okay, the minimum of the potential may be at a non-zero value of the scalar field, which breaks the symmetry spontaneously. And the result is that you got a massless scalar at the end. When you studied the fluctuation around that minimum, we found a massless scalar. And the physical interpretation of that was also quite clear, that once the symmetry is broken, okay, that means that now you don't have a unique vacuum. You have a family of vacuum, family of minima or the potential, okay, which are related by the symmetry transformation. And along those directions, because the potential doesn't change, the mass square of the corresponding scalar should be zero, okay, because the second derivative is vanished. So today we'll generalize this result. Okay, I'll not try to give a general proof, but state the result. But you'll see that this is understandable from physical point of view. So the situation that we'll be considering is a case where you have a multi-component scalar field phi transforming in some representation R. These scalars could be real or complex, so we will not make any assumption. In general, we will assume that the representation R that you are using, so this is a representation R of some symmetric group. G. We assume that the representation is unitary. If the scalar field is real, then that would mean the representation is orthogonal. Okay, because real unitary matrices are orthogonal matrices. But we leave it undecided for now. So the transformation is phi goes to R of G times phi, with G being some element of the group G. Okay, so take any element of the group G. Okay. It has a representation matrix, okay, which I'll call R of G. This may be some abstract way of describing the group, but this is what is concrete. This is a matrix. Okay, so to every element of G, we can associate a matrix R of G. Okay. And we'll assume that the field phi transforms by this transformation, and that the kinetic term as well as the potential terms are invariant under this transformation. Okay, that's what I mean by saying that it's a symmetric group. Okay, both the kinetic and the potential terms are invariant. Okay. Kinetic term is of course invariant because you will define del mu phi star del mu phi, okay, this is for the complex field, or del mu phi for real field. So that should write phi dagger because we are thinking in terms of vectors. So for complex representation, del mu phi dagger del mu phi, this is obviously invariant because you have RG dagger RG coming in here. Okay, and for unitary representation, that's identity. If phi is real, then R is orthogonal, so you have R transpose R coming in here, that's also identity. Okay, so kinetic terms are manifestly invariant. Okay. But we'll assume that V of phi is invariant. So V of RG phi is equal to V of phi for every G, for all G in R. Is this okay? Okay, some potential that is invariant under a certain symmetric group. Now let's suppose that phi naught is a minimum of the upper. Okay, not necessarily unique, it does some minimum. Now we want to see what RG does to phi naught. Okay, this is a meaningful question. Phi naught is some vector, right, which is giving some minimum of the potential. Okay. RG is some matrix. So we can multiply RG by RG on phi naught and ask what vector do we get. So there are two possibilities. One is that this is equal to phi naught. The other one is that this is not equal to phi naught. If this is equal to phi naught, we say that G is unbroken. And if this is not equal to phi naught, we say that G is broken.
This is for all g.
This for any g, any particular g, right? We have to ask, take any particular g, okay, in this group, okay, and ask what happens when rg acts on phi naught. Okay. The answer may not be universal for all g, right? For some g it may be like this, for some g it may be like this. Okay. For those for which rg phi naught is equal to phi naught, for those we'll say g is unbroken in this particular vacuum, okay, in this particular minimum. If this is not equal to phi naught, we will say G is broken in this particular minimum.
So when you say equal to phi naught means no phase factor also, because
RG
in general can be...
No, no phase factor also, it's equal to phi naught. Right? It's not multiplied by anything. Is this okay?
Should it be capital G which is unbroken?
No. As I said, if this... Answer to this question may depend on which particular element of capital G you have chosen, right? So at this stage you are looking at each element of capital G. Capital G is a group, right? We are picking each element of capital G and asking what happens when the representation matrix for that element act on phi naught. Okay. It may happen that for some element it leaves phi naught unchanged, for some element it doesn't leave phi naught unchanged. Okay. For those elements for which phi naught is unchanged, you will say that those are unbroken, because those are not changing the minimum.
Okay.
For those for which it is not the case, we will say those are broken because they are actually acting on the minimum and taking to a different configuration. Okay, to a different minimum.
In G, the groove elements means, is that the thing that means actually the parameters corresponding to which this is broken or unbroken, that should one should tell that. Because some group element is G, that can be represented, suppose some epsilon at TA in that form.
E to the power I epsilon at TA. Yeah, if it's not, yeah, if it's infinitesimal, then it's 1 plus I epsilon at TA. If it's not infinitesimal, there is a parameterization, yes.
So actually, the broken and unbroken is decided in terms of the generator, some of the generators are means.
No, I'm not thinking of that way now. Eventually, we'll think of it that way. Right now, we are just taking each element of the group separately. And you are asking, does it leave phi naught unchanged or does it change phi naught?
Yeah.
Okay. So take for example SU2, okay, which is three-dimensional rotation.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, that is understandable. SO3. Take SO3. Rotation in three dimension. Okay. Suppose if you take SO3, G equal to SO3, so this is an example. Okay. And suppose phi is a three-dimensional representation, phi1, phi2, phi3. Transforming in the standard representation of SO3, which is that R of G times phi is this orthogonal matrix. Orthogonal matrix acting on phi 1, phi 2, phi 3. Okay. Now you can parameterize an orthogonal 3 by 3 orthogonal matrix in many different ways, right? One standard way is Euler angles. Is that familiar? A 3 by 3 orthogonal matrix can be parameterized by Euler angles. Okay, but doesn't matter. Take any parameterization, okay? 3 parameter parameterization. Okay. And now suppose phi naught is 0, 0, a. Okay? Yeah, minimize the potential. Okay, imagine that the potential has a minimum at 0, 0, a for some constant a. Now, which SO3 matrices will leave this unchanged? Rotation about the third axis, right? Rotation about the third axis is given by cos theta, sine theta, cos theta, and then 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 1, right?
Minus.
So these are unbroken. Right? Because these acting on 0, 0, a will give you back 0, 0, a. All the other elements are broken. Right? They, when they act on 0, 0, a, doesn't give you back 0, 0, a. Is this clear? So now sometimes it may happen that the all the elements leave it unbroken. Okay? If it has 0, 0, 0, if I not had been 0, 0, 0, right? If the minimum had been at the origin, then all the elements will give you back 0, 0, 0. Right? Sometimes it may happen that none of the elements give you remain unbroken, right? In this case it's not possible. With a single scalar it's not possible. Okay? But you can imagine that we have say two scalars. That instead of having one single scalar, this phi may contain two scalars, okay? Two three-dimensional representations. A six-component field, which you can divide into three and a three, okay? Suppose the first one, at the minimum, the first one took the value 0, 0, a, and the second one took the value a, 0, b. Then none of the group elements leave it invariant. Okay, maybe a discrete one.
Some identity element will always.
No, identity of course is always true. But yeah, if it's a ON, then you could have taken 1 minus 1, 1. That would have left it invariant. But in SON, SO3, you don't have anything. And in O3, you could take the matrix 1, minus 1, 1, right? That when acts on this and this will give you back these matrices. Right? That's just a discrete element. But, okay, in SO3, you can say all are broken. Okay, if this was the minimum. Okay. So, in general, it so happens that some will leave it unbroken, some will be broken. Is this part here?
And we will always consider only the continuous, means broken symmetry. Means if there are some, suppose discrete symmetries remains, still remains.
Yes.
Still remains unbroken, we will not consider those.
No, we will consider those.
Okay.
Right? Is that they will not play any role in determining how many massless scalars you have. Right? In general, those may be significant because if some discrete symmetries remain unbroken, that means they are symmetries of the correlation function. Right? Because in the first example that we did, it was all discrete symmetry. Right? And there it did make a difference of that the symmetry is unbroken or broken. Right? The correlation symmetry of the correlation function was reflected that problem. Right? So it is certainly important to see, even if there are some discrete symmetries which are unbroken, right? Is there that for the purpose of determining the massless spectrum, those will not be relevant ones.
actually this thing also can exist in nature also. Some discrete broken symmetry.
Yes, it can certainly exist. That you can have a continuous group, right? And the field takes a vacuum expectation value, right? Such that some discrete symmetry is unbroken. That can
happen. Or broken. Some zero symmetry
is broken. Yes, it can be, that can also happen. If the theory has a zero symmetry, it's broken. Okay. So now, let's suppose that H is the set of elements, is a subset of elements of G, which are unbroken. That means any element of H, H of course is a subset of G, any element of H has a property that corresponding R of H on phi naught is phi naught. Okay. So if H is in A, this implies that R of H on phi naught is phi naught. Is this clear? Okay, so that's the unbroken set. So what you are going to show now is that H is a subgroup. Okay, H is, I mean, we have defined H as a subset. Okay, but we will now show that H is actually a subgroup of G. Okay, now what we have to show in order to show that it's a subgroup. Okay, the non-trivial part is that if H1 belongs to H and H2 belongs to H, then product of H1 times H2 should also belong to H, right? So suppose if H1 and H2 belongs to H, then this implies that R of H1 on phi naught is phi naught, and R of H2 on phi naught is phi naught. So to check if H1 H2 is in H, we have to check if R of H1, H2 on phi naught, okay, if this gives us back phi naught or not. But since R is a representation, okay, this is given by R of H1 times R of H2 times phi naught. But R of H2 on phi naught is phi naught. And R of H1 on phi naught is phi naught. So this is phi naught. Okay, so this implies that H1, H2 is in H. Is this clear? Now, we'll consider a general case where, as I said, where H is not necessarily G. Okay, H is not just identity or neither is it G. Okay, in general, it is some proper subset or proper subgroup of G. So this means that we'll assume that there are some elements of G which are not in H. Okay, which actually change phi naught. Okay, if all elements of G were in H, okay, that basically means that the whole group is unbroken. In which case things are more or less trivial, right? There are no massless particles, everything is all symmetries are preserved. Okay. So consider the case where there are some elements of G which are not in H. Okay. So let's suppose that G naught belongs to G, but G naught doesn't belong to H. So now we can consider a phi naught prime, which is R of G naught times phi. So this is not equal to phi naught in general. But since G was a symmetry of the potential, it is guaranteed that R of G naught on phi naught, which is phi naught prime, is also a minimum of the potential. If phi naught is a minimum of the potential, right, V was perfectly symmetric under G transformation, right? So phi naught prime better be a symmetry, a minimum of the potential. Is this clear? Right? This is what we discussed last time, right? When there is a symmetric group of U1, right? We picked one particular minimum, right? Which is where phi was real, right? But then we could make a phase transformation by e to the I alpha, all of them are minimum, right? So any symmetry that is broken, okay, like G naught, has a property that when you apply it on phi naught, on the original minimum, it generates another minimum. Is this clear? Minimum but the potential has the same value. Okay, in fact, this will generate a whole family of flat directions. So now suppose we chose to work not at phi naught, but at phi naught prime. Okay. And you want to ask that what is the unbroken subgroup at phi naught prime? Right? So it's clear that it's not going to be H. Right? Because in general, RH on phi naught prime is not equal to phi naught prime in general. Okay, so this is for H belongs to H.
But, sir, but all points are equivalent, all the minimum.
Yes.
So why the group is different?
Well, we'll see in what sense it's different. Okay. All I have said is that as a subgroup, this is, it's the same element of H. Mm. Okay, are not going to leave phi naught prime invariant. Okay, that's okay. Let's see why this is the case. See, RH on phi naught prime is RH times RG naught on phi naught. Right? Because phi naught prime is RG naught on phi naught. If H had commuted with G naught, you could have taken RH on that side and said that RH on phi naught is phi naught and you get back phi naught prime. But in general, H and G naught doesn't commute, right? So RH, RG naught, okay, you cannot replace it by RG naught, RH. Is that clear? Okay. So let's not worry too much about it. Okay. Let's ask, what is the unbroken subgroup for phi naught prime? Which elements of G leave phi naught prime unchanged? Okay? So let's say that H prime is a subset of elements of G for which such that R H prime on phi naught prime is equal to phi naught prime implies H prime belongs to H prime. Okay, so the definition of H prime the state of all elements of G, which leaves phi naught prime unchanged. Yes. Yes, you can readily say that H prime is again a subgroup. Okay, but it's certainly not the same subset of elements of G. Right?
Necessarily different.
Pardon?
Will be necessarily different.
They will be necessarily different as long as the G is non-abelian, right? As long as the H and G do not commute. Right? As a subset, they are different. Okay? But at the same time, we know that somehow the physics shouldn't change. If we just go from one vacuum to another, related by symmetric transformation, right? Okay, this is what we have been emphasizing yesterday also, right? That over the whole circle, anywhere you want, you should get the same physics. Okay, so you have to see in what sense you get the same physics. Okay, even though the unbroken subgroup is not the same element, same subset of G. Okay. So it turns out that even though H prime and H are different, we can actually generate elements of H prime from the elements of H. Okay. And here is the precise relation. Yes, they will be isomorphic eventually, right? That's what you want to show. Okay, that they will be isomorphic. So the claim is the following, okay, which is very easy to prove, that if H belongs to H, then G naught H, G naught inverse belongs to H prime. Okay, so let's try to verify this. So what we have to show, what we have to do to check that this belongs to H prime? That R of this acting on phi naught prime should give us back phi naught prime. Right? That's why we will say that this belongs to H prime. So let's check that R of G naught H, G naught inverse on phi naught prime. Okay. So this is R of G naught, R of H, R of G naught inverse, R of G naught on phi naught. Right? By the property of the representation, R of G naught H, G naught inverse is R of G naught, R of H, R of G naught inverse. So R of G naught inverse I can write here. Is that clear? This is the representation of this product, right? So which is the product of the representations. Mm-hmm. Okay, and the inverse of a representation of an inverse is the inverse of the representation. And phi naught prime I wrote phi R G naught on phi naught. So this is of course identity. Then R of H on phi naught, okay, by definition is phi naught, because H is in H, capital H, right? So R of H on phi naught gives you phi naught. So this gives you R of G naught on phi naught, which is phi naught. Is this point clear? Okay. And the reverse is also true. So reverse is if H prime belongs to H prime, then G naught inverse H prime, G naught belongs to H. Okay, proof is identical. He just reverse it. Are there questions? So this relation, if you have two subsets, two subgroups of it, take a subgroup of G, okay, and take another subgroup, okay, with the relation that every element of the first subgroup is G naught times the second element of the second subgroup times G naught inverse. This generates isomorphic subgroups. Is that familiar? Familiar or not familiar? And if you take H1 and H2, the product law is identical. Yeah, basically, if you take H1 prime, H2 prime, okay, this is the conjugate. So this is what's known as conjugation, right? Taking an element H and making it G naught H, G naught inverse is like conjugation by G naught, right? That's the definition of conjugation. Okay. So if H1 prime is the conjugation of H1 and H2 prime is the conjugation of H2, then H1 prime, H2 prime is the conjugation of H1, H2. Okay. Using this, we consider the group composition laws are identical in these two. Because H1 prime, H2 prime is like G0, H1, G0 inverse, G0, H2, G0 inverse, which is G0, H1, H2, G0 inverse. Okay. So you make this map from an element of capital H to an element of capital H prime, okay, one-to-one map by this conjugation, okay, that the first element, the an element H goes to H prime, which is G naught H, G naught inverse. Okay. Under this map, the product laws go into each other. Okay, if H1, H2, okay, goes on to the conjugate of H1, H2, right, which means that the group composition laws are isomorphic. Okay, are identical, and hence H and H prime are isomorphic. H, H prime are isomorphic. So it is in this sense that physics remains unchanged. Okay, while the actual subset of G which leaves phi naught prime unchanged is different from the subset that leaves phi naught unchanged. Okay. Nevertheless, the unbroken subgroup around phi naught is isomorphic to the unbroken subgroup around phi naught prime. And hence, when you study the theory, okay, find this mass spectrum and so on, you will not see any difference. Okay, all minima which are related by this G transformation, okay, will all give the same physics. Is this point clear?
Will it be like this, the main group, that will be equals to the group product of this group and the unbroken group?
No. In general, it is not the case. Right? In fact, it's not even true in the case of SO3. Right? In the example that we gave, right? SO3 gets broken to SO2. Mm. Right? But the group is not a product. Right? SO3 is not SO2 times something. Right? You can define a coset, left coset and right coset, yeah, but it's not a product. SO3 is not SO2 times something. Right? So in general, you don't get into, it's not, that doesn't have the product structure. So are there questions? Okay, so now, let's consider infinitesimal transformations. Okay, because now you want to actually count how many massless fields there will be. So infinitesimal transformation. Okay. So suppose TA with A running from 1 to NG are the generators of G. Okay, so these are useful for infinitesimal transformations. So for infinitesimal G,
so infinitesimal G,
infinitesimal G, we have the structure that RG is 1 plus I epsilon A, okay, sum over A running from 1 to N. Now, H is a subgroup of G. So you can also consider infinitesimal elements of H, which are also infinitesimal elements of G. Okay? H is a subgroup of G. Infinitesimal elements of H are also infinitesimal elements of G. Okay? So the generators of H, okay, will be linear combinations of the generators of G in general. Okay? Less in number, because H in general is a subgroup. So the number of generators of H is less than that of G. In the example that we consider SO3, SO2, right? SO3 has 3 generators, right? SO2 has only 1 generator. Okay, so the number of generators of H is typically less than that of G. Okay? And in general, there are linear combinations of the generators of G. Okay? But we can always choose, okay, the generators of G in such a way, such that first set, first few, represent the generators of H. Okay, this is our choice, because I can, how I choose the TS, I can take any linear combination and declare them as our TS. Okay. So let's suppose that P alpha, okay, for alpha equal to 1 to NH are generators of H, are generators of H.
This figure always
because
H forms a subgroup of G.
Yes, because H forms a subgroup of G. Mm. Okay? So any generator of H is clearly a linear combination of generators of G, because any generator of H, any infinitesimal element of H is also an infinitesimal element of G. Right? Okay. And then Pk with K running from NH plus 1 to NG, these will be other generators. Other generators. So now we use the fact that 1 plus I epsilon alpha, T alpha, on phi naught equal to 0, equal to phi naught. Okay, because H leaves phi naught unchanged. So this means that T alpha phi naught is 0. On the other hand, Pk phi naught is not zero, zero in general. Pk phi naught is not equal to zero. Is this clear? Because Pk phi naught is representing elements of G which are not in H, so they do not leave phi naught unchanged. Okay. So by definition, 1 plus I epsilon ATA, when A takes value from NK plus 1 onwards, does not give us back phi naught. Okay. So TK phi naught shouldn't be 0. So this means what? This means that if you consider V of 1 plus I sum over A equal to NK plus 1 to NG of epsilon A. Mm-hmm. phi naught plus epsilon h e phi naught. This is equal to p of phi naught. I could have included a equal to 1 to nh part, but those will be 0 anyway. Okay, because d alpha on phi naught gives you 0. Right? This is for alpha equal to 1 to nh. Okay, so the non-trivial part of the information is coming from here. That if you make deformations, okay, this is a statement that V is symmetric. V is invariant under a symmetric transformation, right? So V, so the general statement is what? V of R G on phi naught is phi naught, is V of phi naught. Right? In general, V, I will not put phi equal to phi naught. This is the general statement. Now I am putting phi equal to phi naught, but at phi equal to phi naught, we know that if we take an infinitesimal RG, the first NE generators doesn't do anything to phi naught. Okay, they give us 0. Okay. So I can replace this by A equal to NT plus 1 to NG. NH plus 1, thank you. NH plus 1 to NG.
So all
TJ
phi naught not equal to 0?
So all TK phi naught not equal to 0, because if any linear combination of TKs had annihilated phi naught, would have included that into a generator of H. Okay. Right? So no linear combination of the TKs should leave phi naught unchanged. Right? Otherwise they would have been counted as generator of H. Is this point clear? Yeah, so by the definition, whatever could annihilate phi naught, right, whatever leaves phi naught unchanged has already been included in the first NH counting. Okay. So after that, okay, in of the NG minus NH that is left over, there should be no linear combinations of those generators which can annihilate phi naught. Because if there were, we would have included this into the definition of H. Okay, it would have been a bigger subgroup. Okay. So this means that you can move starting from phi naught. There are NG minus NH directions in which you can move, but the potential doesn't change. This is the analog of that circle that we saw yesterday. Right? Yesterday, starting from the minimum, we applied the e to the phi goes to e to the I alpha phi, and we generated a whole circle of minimum. This is the infinitesimal version of that. But now we are seeing that it's not just a circle. It's a high dimensional space, and the dimension of the space that it spans is ng minus nh. There are these many ways you can deform from phi naught. You can go away from phi naught, okay, along with the potential is remaining unchanged. So this gives you ng minus nh dimensional space of minima of the offer. Is this point clear? Okay. Let's go back to this SO3 example again. Okay. We have taken 0, 0, A, right? That was our starting point. Okay. And SO2 was unbroken. Okay. Now, what is the space of minima? SO3 was a symmetry, right? You can just think geometrically. 0, 0, A is a minimum, right? So, what is the whole space of minimum?
S2, I mean the sphere.
Yeah, so it's 0, 0, A is a vector along Z direction, right? Mm-hmm. But now you can apply any rotation on that vector, right? That generates another minimum. So if you start with a vector along the z direction and apply an arbitrary three-dimensional rotation, right, what space will you generate?
A sphere
of radius A, right? Any vector, okay, ABC or not ABC, say MNP, okay, with square root of M square plus N square plus P square equal to S square or equal to A, can be generated from 0, 0, A, right? So that's a two-dimensional space. Okay, and that's exactly what you see here. Okay. NG in that case was 3. SO3 has 3 generators, right? NH, which is SO2, has one generator. Okay. So you expect a two dimensional space of minima. Is that clear? And the two dimensional space is the surface of the sphere that this vector is generating. Okay, so space of phi you can think of as a three dimensional space because you have phi 1, phi 2, phi 3. Okay. And in this three dimensional space, you take a sphere of radius A, which is a two dimensional surface. Okay. And all of these are possible minima of the potential. So this is a general statement that if G is the total subgroup, total group of symmetry, and if H is the unbroken subgroup, then the space of minima that you have is Ng minus Nh dimension. Okay, and you generate that space by starting with the original phi naught and apply transformations in G which are outside H. Okay, because if you take transformations in G which are in H, it doesn't do anything. Okay, just like rotation about the z-axis. Okay, to generate the sphere, you have to generate or you have to rotate not about the z-axis but about the other axis, right? So that you go to different vectors. And then by the same geometric intuition, you can see that this means that there will be Ng minus Nh massless bosons. Okay, because the potential doesn't change in those directions, right? So any fluctuation in those along the sphere direction will generate massless particles. Okay, and the number is Ng minus Nh because that's the dimension of the space.
H will always be at least be 1, right? Because identity will always be
1. So, NH is the dimension of the number of generators. So, if the group is broken to identity, then the number of generators is 0. Okay. Right? So, NH is not the number of group elements. Okay? But it's the number of generators, that means number of parameters that level the group element. Okay? So, if it's just identity, then the number of parameters is 0. Okay? So, if the group is fully broken, then if no element of G other than identity leaves the point vacuum unchanged, then the total number of massless fields will be Ng. Okay, so this is what is called the Goldstone's theorem. This, I mean, I have done it classically, okay, but one can show that this feature continues to hold even after taking into account all quantum corrections, okay, which we will see later, that in general quantum corrections can change the masses. Okay, what you think of masses at by doing this three level analysis can actually undergo change, but this feature doesn't change. Okay, that if there are a symmetric group G is broken to H, okay, then even after taking into account all quantum corrections, okay, you will continue to get Ng minus Nh massless scalar fields. So now we are going to discuss a somewhat different topic, okay, which is of course related to this. Okay. Then the question that you want to ask now is what happens if these groups that we have been discussing so far were actually local symmetric groups, gauge symmetric groups. Okay. And which means that there would have been gauge fields associated with these groups, G, okay, and hence also H. And what would be the fate of this general results in that case. Okay. So, we'll try to explore this again by going back to the simple example of a single complex scalar. Okay. We took a single complex scalar, but the only difference now will be that we'll assume that there is a gauge field, okay, and the symmetry that we had, phi goes to e to the I alpha times phi, actually is a local symmetry where alpha can be a function of x. So you take a charged scalar, phi, proper to a U1 gauge field in. Okay, these are the Maxwell field. Okay, this abelian group. So far we are not going to discuss any non-abelian gauge field at this stage. So the action for this will be minus 1/4 integral f mu nu d4x minus integral d mu phi d4x minus integral d phi star. F mu nu as usual is del mu A mu minus del mu A mu. D mu phi is del mu phi minus IG A mu times phi. And for V, I'll take exactly the same potential that you took yesterday. Okay, so that we can use all the results that we had, which is minus mu square phi star phi plus lambda phi star phi square. Is this okay? So this has a gauge symmetry. Check gauge symmetry. Under which phi goes to e to the power I g alpha of x times phi of x, and a mu goes to a mu. Because a mu plus del mu alpha, so this gives you minus ig del mu alpha times phi and etc. And when del mu acts on the I alpha phi, it gives you I del mu alpha, and those cancel. So the action is gauge invariant. Okay, each term in the action by construction is gauge invariant. Now, by the fact that the potential has this structure, that again, this again means that phi equal to 0 is a maximum. Okay, that's not the correct point around which you start expanding the action. Okay. So you have to go back to the minimum, right? And that analysis is exactly what we did yesterday. Okay, where the minimum of the potential is, that analysis can be done independently of the rest of the terms in the action. Okay, so the minimum is at this point mu square over 2 lambda. So d phi has minimum, say minimum, at phi equal to square root of mu square by 2 lambda. Okay, so we define chi. Find chi equal to 1 over root 2 chi 1 plus I chi 2 to be phi minus square root of mu square by 2 lambda. Okay, or you can say phi I can write as square root of mu square by 2 lambda plus 1 over root 2 chi 1 plus I chi 2. So what we are going to do is to substitute this in the action and expand. This part, of course, doesn't care about phi. Okay, so this part will remain unchanged. For this part, we can use the result that we derived yesterday. Okay, because that's the expansion of E I phi star. Only this part you have to work out a little carefully. Okay? So minus integral d mu phi star d mu phi, this is minus integral del mu phi star plus I g d mu phi star d4x. Times del mu phi minus I g a mu phi for x. And now I'll substitute for this. Substitute this expression for phi. And I'll leave it as an exercise. Let me write a this gives you minus half is an exercise. Okay, it's straightforward algebra from what we have. Okay. So it's not hard to understand where it's coming from, right? This del mu phi star del mu phi. Right? That gives you the first two terms. Right? Because in del mu phi this part drops out. So these two terms come from a del mu phi star del mu phi term. Then there is a g square a mu phi star phi. Right? G square mu mu phi star phi. So when you substitute for phi, square root of mu square by 2 lambda, that has a term mu square over 2 lambda g square mu mu. Okay, I should have written that this is not the end of it. Plus cubic and quartic in fields. Okay, which will not worry about too much now. Okay, cubic terms come because after all there is an mu mu phi star phi, you also have mu mu chi star chi, and that's a quartic term. Okay, so similarly some cross term, but cubic and quartic terms you don't worry because they are interaction terms. But as far as the quadratic term is concerned, this is what we get. Okay, so these terms come from the cross ig mu phi star del mu phi, that's one term, and then minus ig mu phi del mu phi star, that's another term. When you express in terms of chi 1 and chi 2, you will find that this is what you get. Is this clear? Okay, it's some algebra, but you should be able to get that easily from there. Okay, up to this mu chi chi and mu chi chi kind of term. So this is just the middle term, this one. Okay, we still have these two.
That's what you have to
write. But at this stage, you see that there is something strange which is happening here. There is some cross terms between mu and chi. Okay, so the mu's and chi's don't quite decouple, right? Earlier, I mean, from our experience, we have seen that the kind of terms that you are getting, right? Of course, there is a coupling between the various fields when you go to cubic and higher order, right? But for example, at the quadratic level, right, the scalar fields had their own kinetic term, gauge fields had its own kinetic term, fermions had its own kinetic term, and so on. Now that's no longer the case. There is some kind of cross term that arises, and this cross responsibility for this cross term is simply because phi has gotten a vacuum expansion value, right? So phi has a constant piece, right? So we expand in terms of chi, there's a constant piece, and that constant piece is responsible for this cross term, which you can also see. This is exactly the expectation value of phi, right? Where the minimum is. So the first thing we'll do is to try to repair it. And in this case, it turns out that repairing it is not very hard. Okay. We have to define b mu. So define b mu as a mu minus and we will think of b mu as our independent variable rather than a mu. Is this okay? So if we do that, okay, then this term becomes minus half integral d4x del mu chi 1 del mu chi 1 plus mu square over lambda g square.
So this kind of terms, b mu chi which del mu chi 2.
Yes.
We have even in the first case, because x1 is b mu.
When we expand this d mu, oh, see, there what happened is that these cross terms already had is cubic,
yeah.
Right?
As a quadratic level.
Yeah, at the quadratic level, right? Because you want to first calculate the propagator, right? Cubic and higher order terms, of course, are vortices, so they are all fields can mix, right? But to calculate the propagator, normally think of the gauge field propagator as being separate from a scalar propagator and so on. Here, that's not happening, right? There's a mixing. Okay, so you have to unmix it, and one way to unmix it is by using this new field b mu. Where in terms of which this part at least looks unmixed. But of course, you have to now check that you have not started mixing at other levels, right? If you have defined their A mu as a new field B mu, right? You have to check now what F mu becomes. Right? Maybe this introduces a mixing between B mu and chi. Fortunately, F mu is just del mu b nu minus del mu b nu. Okay, because this term simply cancels. Okay? Del mu a nu, okay, so you see, you will have del mu a nu, okay, minus del mu chi. Okay? When you subtract the mu goes to nu exchange, this term just drops out. So f mu still doesn't mix b with chi. Okay, so you have somewhat safe. So let's now write down the action again.
So essentially, we went to b mu from a mu by a gauge transformation where alpha is just chi, right?
Roughly, yes. Okay, that is as if,
yeah,
we have b mu and a mu are related by a gauge transformation where alpha you have chosen to be chi. Right? Well, of course. Normally, you think of alpha as an independent object than chi 2, but it's as if that we have done something like that, and that's the reason why the expression for f mu doesn't change when you write in terms of p.
So, does it reduce
your
field? I mean,
well, we will see what it does. Let me write down the full action and then we'll worry about what exactly has happened.
So you're only looking for mixing, whether there's mixing
in quantity, because higher order mixing, there's vortices always mix fields, right? So that you don't worry about. That you are familiar with, that vortices always mix fields. So now we write the action as minus 1 quarter integral d4x f mu nu minus half integral d4x. Here you have del mu chi 1 del mu chi 1 plus mu square over lambda g square d mu d mu. And then you have to look at the V. Okay, the term that comes from V. This is the gauge field part, this is the d mu phi star, d mu phi term, and then from V. And there I will just use what we got last time, which is minus integral d4x mu square chi 1 square. Plus cubic and higher order terms, which of course comes from here as well as from here. The potential has cubic and higher order terms. Right? Yesterday you worked on the potential, right? Which had lots of cubic and higher order terms. And if you want to be very careful, you also have to worry about the constant piece, right? Which it doesn't matter. I think it was mu to the 4 or 4 lambda integral d4x. Okay, this was the part of E which was just mu to the 4 over 4 lambda. Now, if you look at this Lagrangian, you may find that something strange has happened. First of all, so we have not done any gauge fixing or anything, right? So far, we have kept everything.
But this choice,
dmu, chi to
alpha,
is a gauge
choice.
Which choice?
Dmu equal to
mu
minus.
No, this is not a gauge choice. We are not setting anything to zero. This is a change of fields, right? We just you have chosen to use a new field for writing our action. Right? We have not so far constrained any field. Right? So we have not fixed a gauge yet. But what you see here, first of all, that a gauge field, okay, earlier if you remember the gauge field propagator was ill-defined. Right? It was ill-defined because of this problem that kinetic operator had a zero eigenvalue. Okay? Now that is no longer the case. Okay? F mu in terms of B mu, we have still have the problem, right? The same form. But now you have a mass term, right? And you can easily check that once you have this, include this mass term, the kinetic term, the quadratic operator doesn't have a zero eigenvalue. Okay, this mass term basically removes that zero eigenvalue.
Basically, the symmetry is broken.
Well, I mean, gauge symmetry is still very much there. Okay, it's part of the system. Right? It's spontaneously broken, but it is still part of the system. So that's one feature. The second feature is that one field has disappeared from the kinetic term. The chi 2 is not there.
But in cubic and higher order,
it is there. But okay, it is there because you have chosen a specific particular way of labeling things, right? And there is a way to write label fields where it will also disappear from the cubic and higher order terms. Okay, but in this, at this level, it is there. Okay, but at the quadratic level, chi 2 has gone. Okay? So what does that mean? That means the chi 2 propagator is like 1 over 0. Right? Because the kinetic term is 0 for chi 2. It's like 0 times chi 2 square, right? So propagator is 1 over 0. So you have gotten gotten rid of the problem from the gauge field sector. Okay? But the problem has come back in the chi 2 sector, right? Chi 2 propagator is ill-defined. Is this point clear? Okay. So let's now try to understand why it's happening. Right? What has happened in that we have a situation of this kind. Okay. So for this, we have to go back to our understanding of this zero ion field. Right? Why did the gauge field, okay, the original Maxwell's field or the Norman gauge fields, why did the kinetic term have a zero eigenvalue? It had a zero eigenvalue because the theory had gauge invariance, right? Mu changing to mu plus del mu epsilon, right, meant that in the momentum space, the mu was changing by term proportional to k mu, okay? And that told us that k mu should have been a zero eigenvalue, eigenvector is zero eigenvalue. So let's now try to see what has changed. Okay. So to do that, we have to go back and study our gauge transformation laws. So delta mu, we know already. Delta mu is here, it's minus del mu is plus del mu epsilon. Okay, mu goes to mu plus del mu epsilon, right? So change in mu is del mu epsilon. Delta phi. Remember, phi goes to e to the ig alpha of x times phi, right? So when alpha is infinitesimal, well, then alpha, that's what when alpha is infinitesimal, delta phi is equal to ig alpha of x times phi. And we are taking infinitesimal alpha. This is alpha small, alpha infinitesimal. But phi, let me write it here, phi was square root of mu square over 2 lambda plus 1 over root 2 chi 1 plus I chi 2. So this is just a constant. So if delta phi is this, then that means 1 over root 2 delta chi 1 plus I delta chi 2 is given by IG alpha of x times square root of mu square over 2 lambda plus 1 over root 2 chi 1 plus I chi 2. This clear? Yeah? Right? This is not very different from the symmetric transformation that we discussed yesterday, right? Because at this level, right, because this doesn't involve any derivative of alpha, the global and the local symmetries have the same structure, right? Yesterday we saw that when symmetry is spontaneously broken, the chi 1 and chi 2 symmetric transformations take a certain form, and that's what we are writing. Now, we can just compare the real and imaginary parts on both sides and figure out how chi 1 transforms and how chi 2 transforms. So, delta chi 1, right, you have to look for the real part. Okay, that basically comes only from the product of this and this. So, delta chi 1 is minus g alpha chi 2. And delta chi 2, that's the imaginary part, that has one piece coming from here, so that's g square root of g times square root of mu square by lambda times alpha plus g times square root of mu square e times alpha times chi 1. this clear? Right, I derived the transformation laws for chi 1 and chi 2. But now, you see here, the independent variables that I have taken are B, chi 1 and chi 2. Okay? Not any. So you have to see how B mu transforms. Okay? Because you are, well, you are with B mu. Right? So B mu, let me remind you the definition again. B mu was A mu minus square root of lambda over mu square. G inverse del mu chi 2. So delta B mu is delta A mu, which is del mu alpha, minus square root of lambda over mu square G inverse times del mu of delta chi 2. That's times del mu of G square root of mu square by lambda alpha plus g alpha of x chi 1 of x. So let's simplify this. So this is del mu alpha of x minus, you see this lambda over mu square cancels this, g cancels this, so minus del mu alpha of x minus g cancels this, so minus square of lambda over mu square del mu alpha of x by 1 of x. So this is delta b. So del mu alpha cancels. Is this clear? So now let's look at what it should imply for the kinetic terms, right? Because the gauge invariance was responsible for the zero eigenvalue. And the part of the gauge transformation which is responsible for the zero eigenvalue, okay, is a field independent part. Delta A mu equal to del mu epsilon or del mu alpha. Okay, that's what gave that the K mu term, K mu is a zero eigenvector. Okay. The field dependent part, okay, that plays a role only when you take into account the interaction effects. Okay. You see that this term is field dependent. So B mu of course does transform, but it is a field dependent transformation. Just like in the original case, phi, okay, had a field-dependent transformation, right? But this didn't make the phi kinetic term ill-defined, right? So field-dependent terms don't bother us. Okay? One way to see this is that field-dependent terms also come with a coupling constant. Okay? So if you go to the phi limit, okay, where you set the coupling constant to zero, okay, then all the field-dependent terms go away, right? For example, here lambda is one of the coupling constant. If you take lambda to zero, this term goes away. So delta, so in the zero coupling limit, okay, which is where the kinetic term is relevant, B mu is acting as if it's gauge invariant. Okay? B mu is acting like what the field phi was behaving earlier. Okay, because phi does transform, but the transformation goes to zero as you take the coupling constant to zero. Okay? That is a property for B mu. So this is the reason we don't expect that the B mu kinetic term should have problem. Right? Because B mu is gauge invariant, so its kinetic term better have no problem. Right? It should be well defined. In contrast, okay, chi 1 also should have no problem. Right? Because it's also going to 0 as G goes to 0, right? Or it's field dependent. Right? Chi 1 transformation depends on chi 2. But you see chi 2 has a field independent term, alpha of x. Okay, it has a g in the numerator but also a lambda in the denominator. But the important point is that it has a term that is independent of the field. And because of this field independent term, right, if you look at the chi2 kinetic term, it must have a zero eigenvalue. Right? Because if you change chi2 by a constant, the kinetic term shouldn't change. How is that possible? Suppose the kinetic term is chi of k, mk times chi2 of k minus k mk times chi2 of k, right? If you replace chi2 of k by a constant, it should be invariant. How is that possible? Mk times a constant is 0, right? For arbitrary value of that constant. Okay? Mk is not even a matrix, it's a one dimensional number, right? 1 by 1 matrix. So the only choice is Mk must be 0. So the fact that chi2 has no kinetic term, it looks surprising, but it is forced on us by gauge invariance. Right? It's impossible to write a kinetic term for chi2, which will be invariant under a transformation of this kind. Is this point clear? So the problem that we had earlier, that gauge invariance meant that the kinetic terms would be non-invertible, has not gone away. It is there, but it has been transferred from a mu to chi2. Okay, because chi2 is now transforming by a term that is remains even when all fields are set to 0. Right? It transforms a field independent term, whereas the gauge field transformation is like the transformation of the fermion field or the scalar field that we are having earlier, which is field dependent, okay, which goes to 0 as the fields go to 0. Is this point clear? So we have to resolve this problem, right? Chi2 has no propagator. We know how to resolve this problem. We have a gauge fix. It's clear that that's what we have to do. Gauge fixing procedure is exactly identical, right? I mean, whatever we had done about gauge fixing, right? That didn't depend on the form of the gauge transformation or how what fields transform how. Right? Whenever there is a symmetry, we have a well-defined algorithm for gauge fixing. Right? So here you have one parameter, alpha. Right? So you have to fix one function and set it equal to 0. One function of the fields set equal to 0. Right? That should be the gauge choice. But in this case, there is a natural choice. Okay, it's not essential. Okay, we can use many other choices. In fact, this is natural from physics viewpoint, but it's not very useful for calculations, okay, for reasons that we'll see later. The natural gauge choice here, okay, is that you choose the gauge fixing function to be chi2. H of x equal to chi2 of x. Okay? Then when you insert in the path integral, the delta of h, that's setting delta of chi2. Okay. Now, unlike in the previous case where you had a delta of del mu mu and you have to exponentiate to make it, bring it in the form of an action. If you have something like a delta of chi2 inserted in the action, you do not have to do anything. You just set chi2 equal to 0 in the rest of the action. Right? And forget about any path integral over chi2. Right? So, this is the simplest possible gauge choice, right? You just set chi2 equal to 0. So you gauge fix by choosing h of x equal to chi2 of x. Okay. So in the action you have delta of chi2 of x, which basically means that just remove integration over chi2 and set chi2 equal to 0 in that.
What is the gauge symmetry left over?
Pardon?
What is the gauge symmetry left over? Because you did the gauge fixing.
Yes, so now there will be no gauge symmetry left over.
So there is no gauge symmetry, but you did the gauge fixing.
No, there is a gauge symmetry. This is gauge symmetry, right? This is a symmetry we are fixing.
For B's.
For B's there is nothing, but who told you that gauge symmetry has acted on B?
Yeah.
Right? We said whenever there is a gauge symmetry, we fix it.
It could be anything.
It could act on anything, right? When you use those variables U, remember that we started with the S of U, which has a gauge invariance, right? Which has an invariance, and we describe how to fix it, right? The fact that it acts non-trivially on A mu, right, one was never used. Yeah, that is a completely general procedure for gauge fixing.
So now you have like two equivalent realizations. Is that
correct? Well, there's only one theory.
There's only one theory, but
yes.
When you have a different gauge fixing, this side you have B has a mass.
Yes.
And then chi 2 is massless.
Yes.
And you're fixing.
Chi 2 is not massless. Chi 2 has no kinetic term.
No kinetic term. So you're fixing the gauge for chi 2.
But I could have fixed the gauge for A mu also.
If you are thinking in terms of A mu,
mm-hmm.
in that case also you are in broken phase.
Yes.
But you are in you don't see these facts because you are.
No, no. We'll see all those facts. We'll do the gauge fixing also for A mu. Okay. We can do the gauge fixing exactly as we did earlier. Add a del mu A mu whole square term in the action.
Yeah. You do a different gauge fixing here on this side by A mu by 1/.
Yes, 1 by alpha
so
times L mu M whole
so
square.
So, you have two sides. For the same theory, you do two different gauge fixings.
But, I have told you that for the same theory, you have infinite number of gauge fixings, right?
Yes, yes.
So, this is only two of those.
But, how do I show that, what do I calculate to show that they are equivalent?
Because, we started with an original path integral, right?
So, what operator, what correlation function should I...
Gauge invariant correlation functions.
So, if I calculate any gauge invariant correlation on both sides...
Exactly. Because you prove that starting from gauge invariant correlation functions, right? This whole procedure of gauge fixing is just manipulating path integrals, right? So you should get the same result, irrespective of what gauge fixing condition you choose, right? And it's exactly that we are using here. All we are saying here is that there is a convenient choice of gauge fixing function, which is chi 2. Okay? It's convenient for physical interpretation, as I said. It's not very convenient for calculations. Okay, particularly when you go to loop amplitudes for reasons that we will explain later. But nobody can prevent you from choosing any gauge fixing function as long as transverse to the gauge orbit. Right? So you have to make sure that as you make a gauge transformation, chi 2 changes. Right? And it does change, right? But del mu mu also changes. A mu still transforms to A mu plus del mu alpha. Right? D mu doesn't transform at a linear order, but A mu does. So I could have added 1 over alpha times del mu mu whole square. Right?
So when I think of the correlation functions,
yes.
So I can think of 2-point correlation functions for x1, x1, chi 1, chi 1.
Yes.
So that I can calculate on both sides.
Yes.
But chi 2's field itself is...
But chi 2 is not gauge
invariant.
But you have to use two. I mean, the only things which are guaranteed to be the same on both sides is gauge invariant correlation functions.
Yeah.
Right?
So I can only think of chi 1. Yeah, is there anything else?
F mu nu.
F mu nu.
Yes.
And then derivatives of A.
Yeah, I mean all polynomials of these. Right, so all of these are gauge invariant objects. That S matrix in general will be gauge invariant. Right. So the point is that you start, as long as you are dealing with gauge invariant objects, right? What we had shown is that as long as you are considering correlation functions of gauge invariant operators, the gauge fixing function doesn't matter, right? Whatever correlation functions you calculate, you should get the same answer, irrespective of what gauge fixing condition you choose. But if you are asking questions about chi 2 correlation function, it's not a gauge invariant question, right?
Yeah.
And that will depend on the choice of gauge. Right? Here you will get one answer. If you use a del mu mu whole square gauge, that whatever alpha del mu mu whole square addition gauge, you get a different answer for chi 2 correlation.
Because chi 2 is not gauge invariant, we won't get any information about massless Goldstone fields.
You are not supposed to use chi 2 correlation functions to look for massless Goldstone fields. You have to, in a gauge theory, you can only use gauge invariant operators to look for particle spectrum. Right? If you calculate mu nu correlation function in Feynman gauge, you will get lots of states, right?
So by calculating correlation functions, you cannot tell whether the symmetry is broken or not.
If you calculate correlation functions for gauge invariant operators, you can. You can see if there are massless particles or not.
Hmm.
Right? You can see, look at the spectrum. Okay, so what I'm saying is that at this stage, what you, chi 2 equal to 0 gauge, right, and del mu mu equal to 0 gauge will give exactly identical result, okay, if you ask the right questions. And if you ask questions about non-gauge infinite of orders, you will get different results in these two different gauges. Is that okay? Okay, so the point is that we set chi 2 equal to 0, right, that gets rid of chi 2 altogether. But we still have to remember that the ghosts have to be included, right? Unless the ghosts become free, okay, because there is a determinant. We have to change, okay, the determinant came from the change of variables, right? So that we still have to take into account. Okay? So let's just work out the ghost field action and then we'll stop for today. So next time we'll analyze it in more detail, this action. So for ghost, we need this. So h of x is chi 2 of x, right? So if you remember the way we determine the ghost action, what is the general formula? It's integral d4x d4y. In this case, there is only one set of ghost fields because there is one gauge fixing function, b of x. Then we have to calculate delta h alpha of x, delta alpha of y, and then c of y. What was h alpha? H alpha was the transformation of h by the gauge transformation parameter alpha. Okay. H is chi 2. Right, h is chi 2. So h alpha with the readout quantities, h alpha is chi 2 plus g square root of mu square by lambda alpha of x plus g alpha of x chi 1 of x. Right? Just calculating how chi 2 transforms. That's the meaning of h alpha. Right? That how h transforms under the alpha, under the infinitesimal transformation parameter alpha. So delta h alpha of x, delta alpha of y is g square root of mu square by lambda delta x minus y plus g chi 1 of x delta x minus y. These are four times the delta function. Is this clear? Is this okay or not okay? So now we are substitute. So you get S goes. The overall sign is not very important. We get g square root of mu square by lambda integral d of x c of x plus g integral d of x c of x. Very happy.
Yeah, means that ghost ghost means kinetic term, means this is not dynamic.
Yeah, so this is good. This tells us what? That the propagator, okay, is the inverse of this. In fact, this you can just absorb in the definition of B, right? And change this one, right? But what it is telling us, the propagator, the ghost propagator has no pole, okay, which is good. You don't have to worry about developing extra poles, right? See, normally what happens when there is a pole, right? You have worry about whether there is a physical particle or not, right?
Yeah.
Okay, and then you have to argue that ghosts are not physical and so on. Here, that problem is not there. See, there simply is no pole in the ghost propagator.
So, the propagator is 1 over g root lambda?
Yeah, root lambda on mu square, right? It's in k independent. Okay. There is an interaction term, right? So, there is a ghost-host Taiwan interaction term. Now, yeah, there is scalar and ghost, so let's use ghost-ghost Taiwan interaction term, right, which you have to include. Okay? Because of this, you need the ghost field. See, if this term was not there, then you could just ignore it, right? Just a constant piece which doesn't interact together. But because of this, we need the ghost. Okay. And this feature, okay, we'll see is actually, I mean, they are everywhere in this gauge. Right? With this gauge choice, okay, there are no unphysical poles in any particle propagator. Right? All poles will be physical. Okay. Unlike in the Feynman gauge, for example, right? But the propagator is eta mu nu over k square, mu mu propagator, right? Eta mu nu over k square, which has four polarization tensors, right? Then you have to argue that two of them are unphysical, right? By calculating the f mu nu f rho sigma polarization function. In this case, you will find that all poles are physical. Okay, that's why this has a name. This is called unitary gauge. Okay? So in this gauge choice, okay, the particle spectrum, okay, that you see is what the correct particle spectrum is. Okay? You don't have to worry about there are some particles which are unphysical and hence should be removed eventually. Right? All poles represent physical particles. Okay? Next time we'll calculate the BB correlation function. Okay? Chi1 actually is simple, right? Chi1 is just like a normal massive field. Okay, of mass 2 mu square. Okay, this doesn't change from what we did yesterday. Okay? Because Chi1 kinetic term. Okay, and the mass term is exactly identical. So chi1 will represent a particle of mass 2 mu square. Okay. And we will see that the gauge field kinetic term, right, the v mu kinetic term is such that all the poles that it has are actually physical poles. Mm. And it will represent a massive vector particle.
So in this case, even for the Abelian theory, we have
a
ghost is important.
In this gauge, yes. In this gauge, even for the Abelian theory, the ghost is important, right? Because chi2 does transform, right? So it's important because there is a field-dependent term in the chi2 transformation. Is this okay? You could have gotten rid of this, right? Using this other variable, r theta variable that we introduced yesterday. You remember that instead of using chi1 plus I chi2, right? We use the r theta variable. In that variable, okay, the theta transformation is just theta goes to theta plus alpha. Okay. And there, if you use theta as your gauge fixing function, okay, then the only transformation will be something like this. Right. The field dependent part will not be there. So in that gauge, the ghost can be ignored altogether. Okay, so we'll continue this tomorrow. Thank you.